is Seaview Trading versus the Commissioner of the Internal Revenue Service. Let's see, I see counsel, see their names, but not their images. There we go. I see an image of Ms. Blatt. Ms. Mr. Sheehan. Okay. All right. Can you hear me?
Yes, okay. I can.
You're both unmuted, so that's good. And you can see the clock in the corner. Ms. Blatt, if you'd like to proceed.
Thank you, and may it please the court. My name is Lisa Blatt, and I represent the taxpayers. If I may, I would like to reserve 3 minutes for rebuttal. There are three reasons this court should hold that delinquent tax returns are filed, and thus the statute of limitations period begins when taxpayers submit these returns to IRS auditors conducting official audits. First is the ordinary definition of filing. Second is the way the IRS has administered the tax code for over 20 years. And third are the compelling reasons that the IRS has identified for why it encourages taxpayers to file delinquent returns directly with auditors and not the service center. First, the ordinary definition of the term file means delivering something to the proper place for official purposes. And that's exactly what happened here. The IRS did not just find this tax return on a sidewalk. It asked the taxpayer for the tax return, it got the tax return, it audited the tax return, and then assessed tax liability based on that tax return.
Ms. Blatt, if I could interrupt you for a moment. As I understand your argument, you're drawing a distinction between returns that are timely filed and returns that are not filed late or delayed. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay, so the other thing I wasn't quite certain when I read your argument was how the rule you propose is intended to be applied. So does it apply only in circumstances in which the IRS employee requests a copy of a return? Or are you suggesting that a rule that allows a filing of a delinquent return with an IRS employee would apply even if the IRS has not requested that return?
So in this case, we take the definition that the policy statement of the IRS and the manual, what the IRS will accept for filing is when an auditor gets a tax return either at the request of the auditor or if the taxpayer submits it. So in this case, you have a submission, but you could have a case where there's an audit, and I guess the taxpayer would submit it without the IRS asking for it. But this is the standard way it comes up. If the IRS doesn't have the tax return, it calls the taxpayer like this did and says, you're missing your tax return, please send it. And that's why the chief counsel memo, the manual, and the paper are all set up where it's usually the IRS officials requesting.
So if a tax return is timely filed, does that mean that it is subject to the place requirement in the regs, specifically in section 1.6031? Does that apply if it's on time?
Yes, I think that's correct. The regulations, and again, just reading directly from the chief counsel's memo, the tax regulations specify various ways taxpayers can file. What the IRS has said is that neither the code nor the Treasury regulations nor any tax reform tells taxpayers what to do or makes any reference to the filing of delinquent returns. And that's why the IRS has construed its own regulations to allow taxpayers to file directly with auditors as both the most efficient way to get the tax return and what's in the best interest of the taxpayer and the service alike.
So when you say the IRS has construed its regs and policy manuals, you're referring to the 1999 advice letter, essentially.
That's correct. Plus the 2006 policy statement and the manual that was not only in existence at the time of these events, but it's also the current manual is set up for IRS auditors to instruct taxpayers to deliver their returns promptly to the IRS examiner conducting an audit.
So the 1999 letter, which provides advice to district counsel, seems to be addressing the sections in the code and in the regs that allow a taxpayer to file a return by presenting it in person to the appropriate person in district counsel, as opposed to what is would apply here to a partnership return, which would require, if it's timely, as you acknowledge, it would be mailed to a server center. So I guess I don't put as much weight on that advice letter also given that it doesn't have any force of law and it's not binding. But going back to your interpretation of the applicable code section 1-6031. So I see in your briefing you acknowledge that the secretary had authority to promulgate that regulation. In fact, by statute, Congress directed the secretary to promulgate regs that address the place of filing, and so the secretary did. And you construe subsection E, which addresses time, place, and manner, to apply only to a timely reg, because the time requirement is in one of the three subsections, section E. If we define a return as only a timely return for purposes of subsection E, do we apply that same definition to the word return throughout this same regulation, throughout 1.6031A1? You see what I'm saying? That this is one regulation section. Part of it is the time, place, and manner requirement, but there are other provisions in it that use the word repeatedly return. Does that only mean a timely return, or does it mean any return?
Yeah, I take it the way we read the regulation and the way the IRS their memo said the regulations don't address it is referring to the filing requirement. You're correct that it's a lengthy regulation that defines return, but I do think the return is just talking about a tax return. It is our emphasis on the word the filing and the timely. But even I do think even if you don't agree with our regulation or our reading of the regulation, two points are pretty clear here. The IRS has said in just unmistakable terms that the regulations don't address the legal return. Second,
in terms of that, where has the IRS said that?
In the 1999 memo, in two footnotes, it says it doesn't, neither the code nor regulations nor tax forms make any reference to the filing of delinquent returns.
Okay, so going back to the reg itself, though, rather than a non-binding opinion, advisory, the regulations have, as you noted, several sections within it, and this particular regulation. It also in the very part and in filing that's defined as timely delinquent. We set forth the requirement content.
Judge Beatty, you cut out on my end. I couldn't hear you.
Yeah, I think you cut out on mine as well.
Sorry about that. Let me see if my papers are touching the microphone. Is that better?
Yes, much better.
Okay. Sorry about that. I must have been rubbing the microphone, which I can't see. I have no idea where it is. what I was trying to do was sort of parse through the regulation 1.6031 with Ms. Blatt. So when we get to section 4, A4, it's captioned failure to file, and then it sets out the consequences for failing to comply with the requirements of the statute 6031A that requires a return, and also this regulation. And then it in turn cross-references statutory sections that provide for penalties, criminal liability, and section 6229A, which is the section that includes the statute of limitations. So you go to 6229A and read the statute of limitations, and it seems to explicitly identify instances where you would have a timely return and an untimely return, because it sets out the filing date will be the later of when it's filed or when it was due. So if the return, if return is limited just to a delinquent return within that section, why does it cross-reference the statute of limitations that seems to envision timely and untimely returns?
And I think these are all fair points. My overarching point is that and we're relying heavily on the fact that it's not that we're saying this manual or the memorandum creates rights. It's just undisputed that for 20 years, the service has been telling taxpayers to file delinquent returns directly with auditors. And even the IRS's own brief cites these same regulations as applying to partnerships. That's in footnote 9. So the IRS has been, and you raise all these incredibly intellectual and precise arguments that the IRS has never made anywhere, because it's been administering the tax code in a way that it wants to help the tax code, the service. In fact, that memorandum is IRS is complaining that it wants the IRS to bar taxpayers from sending delinquent returns to the service center. So it's a little bit rich for the IRS to take the benefit of, you know, your highly intellectual parsing of the statute and regulations that the IRS has not only not taken, has said the opposite. And I hear you.
I have to disagree that it's a highly intellectual parsing. It's just reading. This is what the regulations say. And you're urging an interpretation of the regulation that would mean it only applies to a timely return. But there are things within that regulation that suggest that can't be true. And so what then you fall back to are the IRS manual sections. Particularly sections from 2005 and then the 1999 advice letter. And what concerned me about that is, first of all, the manual isn't binding. It doesn't seem to be the manner, it doesn't seem, and maybe Mr. Sheehan can address this, but it doesn't appear to be something that's directed to taxpayers, it's promulgated for them, that's sent to them, that's published and pushed out to them. It seems to be an internal document that's given very mundane, practical direction to employees, such as if it's a TC, whatever, do this, do that. I mean, codes, numbers, letter codes, something very hard for anyone who's not an expert in tax filing to interpret. Right. But the other problem is that it all postdates by, in some instances, decades, the statute, which was passed in 1954, which gave the secretary the authority to promulgate the reg. And then the regs at issue here, this particular version was in effect in 1999. So if the IRS is truly relying on its manual to fill gaps, and we have to agree, not having a provision for filing a delinquent return is a massive, massive gap in the regulations, right? So they have to have some provision if it's the manual sections. What happens for the decades before those sections that you cite existed?
So Judge Beatty, the IRS's legal analysis is not based on this filing regulation in terms of the service center. It's based on a different set of regulations that the IRS has construed allow taxpayers to file with directly with auditors. And the policy statement, I mean, just clear that the IRS has been for over 20 years telling taxpayers that if you vote to affirm, the IRS can say yay, you get an unlimited amount of time to assess liability, and we'll keep misleading the public. And if I could reserve the rest of my time for rebuttal.
Sorry, I apologize. I was muted to try to silence my hounds, who I have to say have been very, very good about not barking up until this particular argument. So I apologize, counsel. And Mr. Sheehan, if you'd like to go ahead.
Yes, may it please the court. I'm Anthony Sheehan, and I represent the Commissioner of Internal Revenue. Place I'd like to start is with a misconception being advanced by Seaview that somehow giving a return to an auditor is the equivalent of filing. That is not the case. The requirement is meticulous compliance, and the place for filing a tax return is with the service center. That's been, as the court is aware, the statute delegates to the regulation delegates to the instructions, and the instructions say the return is filed at the service center, in this case, the Ogden, Utah service center, and there's no dispute in this case that Seaview's return did not reach the Ogden, Utah service center. Let's look at the
Counsel, what about the argument that the regulations don't specifically address delinquent returns?
If you look at the regulation and look at the terms of it, that's in paragraph E, and paragraph E has three separate numbered paragraphs. There's no connection between them, either through the use of conjunctions or through cross-referencing among them. It sets forth three separate requirements. And interestingly, the requirement of place for filing is the first requirement. If you were going to tie the place for filing to the time for filing, you'd think that the time for filing would be put first as the most important, then the place, and have them linked together. So really, you're looking at regulation that has three independent requirements, and the place for filing is and has always been the service center. If you go back to
courts have always recognized returns that were filed to the wrong place, right? That was sent to the wrong place. If I mail my return to the wrong place, will that be deemed never filed?
If you mail your return to the wrong place, it will be deemed filed when it reaches the correct place.
Correct. So that means that regulation doesn't, that part of the regulation is not meticulously required, correct?
It is meticulously required in that the return has to reach the correct place. If you go to
That's only if the IRS internally submits it to the correct place?
Yes, the return is considered filed when it reaches the correct place. With W.H. Hill, the return going back 90 years was given to the revenue agent who used it in the audit, but it never made it to, at that point, the collector, whose job it was to process the return. The modern analog to the collector is now the service center. That's where the returns are processed. If you look at the Allnut case from the Fourth Circuit in the late 1990s.
So does the IRS get to decide when they forward it to the correct place to then start the statute of limitations? Is it purely in the IRS's discretion to just forward it on to the service center?
The procedures set out direct the IRS to try to obtain delinquent returns and then to forward them to the service center. And they're considered filed when they reach the service center. And that's generally what happens.
Isn't there also procedures when delinquent returns are sent to the IRS agent directly to then have it filed?
If the IRS agent seeks to collect a delinquent return, then the procedures direct the IRS agent to send it along to the service center. It is filed when it reaches the service center. It is not filed when it reaches the auditor.
So what's the distinction if a taxpayer sends it to the wrong place or to the IRS agent directly? It sounds like the procedures requiring them both to be sent to the service center.
Correct. If the taxpayer...
But that didn't happen here, I guess?
That did not happen here because in this case, it was not made clear that we were dealing with a delinquent return. Seaview argued and argued well into the tax court litigation that it filed its return in 2002. What the revenue agent asked for was not send us the delinquent return for filing, but send me a copy of the retained copy and send me the certified mailing materials. It was made clear also in the deposition of CPA Sadaka that he was being asked for a copy, and the transmission was, as per our discussion, here are the documents you asked for. Then in 2007, the mailing to the IRS attorney, it was, here is a copy of the retained copy. So it was never made clear.
So I guess, is your position then that it would have been filed if the IRS agent asked, did you file your 2001 returns? If so, send it here for filing? Versus, I think what happened here was, did you file your 2001 tax returns? If so, please send a copy. So it's just that those turns of phrase makes the distinction of filing here.
The distinction of filing would be that Seaview always had it within its power to mail a document to the service center to make sure it got filed. In fact, that's what the CCA says, you cannot forbid mailing. Seaview also, as a taxpayer and a very sophisticated taxpayer with sophisticated counsel, also could have said, please, we will still maintain our argument, but help us get this document filed. The burden is on the taxpayer to ensure meticulous compliance with the filing.
You, You made that point in your brief that alternatively there should be an obligation on the taxpayer to in fact make sure that it was sent to the appropriate place. But you also have regulations, do you not? And IRS regulations, which indicate that IRS, when they receive this kind of delinquent return, will within 24 hours send the returns to the appropriate place for filing. And you know, it seems to me that you started the investigation, you started talking with the taxpayer, never telling the taxpayer that in fact they should send the return to the appropriate place, even though you had the obligation to do it yourself under the regulations. So, I mean, I guess I'm looking at a fairness argument here. Is this particularly fair when you don't really go to that step of making sure that there is filing, appropriate filing, just by following the regulations and sending it to the appropriate place?
Your Honor, yes, it is fair, and it is good tax administration, because the burden is on the IRS has to deal with millions of taxpayers. The burden is on the taxpayer. Here, the taxpayer, Seaview, was informed, we don't have a record of your return. Seaview's response was, we filed our return back in 2002, and we're going to continue to argue we filed back in 2002. Seaview always had it within its power to comply by sending it, by mailing it. Seaview always had it within its power to say, let's make sure we at least get this later document filed. We'll keep our argument, but let's make sure we get this filed.
But wouldn't the reasonable interpretation of an IRS agent asking for them to send the delinquent returns is that the IRS would then accept it at that point?
It was not made clear at that time that it was anything more than a copy sent to the revenue agent for its own internal use. Look at what happened in the Harold case in the Eastern District of Michigan, where a return was sent.
I mean, the IRS asked, I haven't read it in a while, but doesn't it specifically ask, did you file 2001 tax returns? If so, please send it.
Yes, it asked for a copy of the retained copy. It did not purport to be asking for the delinquent return to pass it along. And the obligation to get it to the service center, to get it to
that
the
That just seems place. Like parsing so closely.
Well, wait, can I ask you something, Mr. Sheehan?
Yes.
Judge Sessions was asking you about IRS regulations. I think he was referring to policy manual section, because the regulations say nothing about IRS employees forwarding a delinquent return or return it filed in the wrong place. That's all in manual.
In the manual. Is that correct? Right. It's in the manual. That's correct.
So can you comment on what is the significance of the manual? I mean, we have case law that says it's not binding, it doesn't have the force of law, it doesn't create rights for taxpayers. But what is this manual? Is it, as Seaview argued, intended to fill gaps in the code or fill gaps within the regulations?
It is not intended to fill gaps within the regulations per se. It is intended to lay out internal procedures within the IRS to administer our massive tax system. It does not create taxpayer rights. Your taxpayer cannot point to the manual and say, as Seaview is trying to do here, that there's a procedure in place to forward returns to the service center. Therefore, we can disregard 90 years of precedent and say that handing a return to a revenue agent is the equivalent of filing with the service center, and that should count. Revenue agents, yes.
Well, as I understand Ms. Blatt's argument, if the return is timely, then the regs apply, including subsection E, time, place, and manner, and so it has to be mailed to the service center. If the return is not timely, then that section, that regulation doesn't apply, and instead you look to manual sections, and then the burden is on the IRS to forward an untimely return to the service center. One way or other, it has to get to the service center. But if you're late, if you don't comply with the regs and you're not on time, you get the benefit of being able to have the IRS correct it for you, which to me seems strange that a timely filing is given less consideration or is not treated as well as an untimely filing. You're delinquent and the IRS is required to file your return for you if you send it to them. including in their argument, send it to them out of the blue. They haven't even asked for it. So, you know, that raises the question, if the reg doesn't apply to delinquent filings, delinquent returns, if Section 6031 doesn't apply, and I don't mean the statutory section, I mean the regulatory section, then is there any statute of limitations for a delinquent return? Because 6031 specifically cross-references 6229A, which is the statutory provision for the statute of limitations. That whole reg doesn't apply to the delinquent return. Why is there even, I mean, logically, then there's no statute of limitations for your untimely return. Because 6229A doesn't apply, the reg doesn't apply.
If I understand your question correctly, Your Honor, the delinquent returns are delinquent. For a return to be delinquent, the due date has already been missed. And so you've already blown the limitations period, if you will, for that return. Now this Internal Revenue
limitations period is triggered by things, right? So
okay,
it's triggered if it's filed that's 3 years from the date of filing or the date that it was supposed to be filed, whichever is the later. If it's never filed at all, then it doesn't start running.
That is correct.
So in this instance, if the regulation 1.6031 does not apply to delinquent regs, then that cross-reference to the statute of limitations doesn't apply either, which means if there are any provision, any manual section, anything we can look to that tells us, well, when does the statute of limitations start to run for a delinquent?
If a return is never filed, the statute of limitations for assessment never starts to run. That's in our case 6229C4, and none of the other statutes of limitations start to run either.
Well, what if a taxpayer files, mails it to the service center, but does it a year late? They're late, it's untimely, they've mailed it to the service center. When does the statute start to run in that instance?
In that instance, the statute would start to run when the return arrives at the service center. At that point, the 3-year period will start to run.
And we know that by looking at 6229A.
Yes, it is 3 years from the time that partnership return is filed.
That gives the IRS a minimum
of 3 years.
But the 6229A doesn't distinguish between timely and untimely returns, does it?
No, it doesn't, because it just says from the time the return, just make sure I get the code section correct here, but it would be the IRS gets a minimum of 3 years from the date on which the partnership return for such taxable year was filed. So the IRS, if the return is delinquent, the taxpayer did not file on time, gets it in a year late, it arrives at the service center, IRS would have 3 years, a minimum of 3 years from the time.
Right, I mean, I'm not disputing what the statute says. I guess the question is that Seaview has set up an interpretation that this particular reg, and I don't know why it doesn't go further, when it says the word return, only means a timely return. Which would mean if we take their argument and apply it to 6229A, that's only applying to timely returns, which is impossible because the statute itself envisions returns filed after the date they were due. And of course, that statute's then incorporated into the reg that applies to the time, place, and manner. What are the consequences if you don't comply? So we have this logical inconsistency between the statutes and the regulation, if they're correct, that the reg only applies to a timely return.
I see my time is up. I will answer your question, any other questions the court might have. We believe that CB's interpretation of the reg is incorrect, that the place of filing applies to all returns. They have to reach the service center before they are considered filed, but once they reach the service center, the 3-year period is triggered. And if there are no further questions, I thank you.
Actually, can I ask a couple of quick follow-ups? Yes. The 1999 Chief Counsel document, does that apply to partnerships as well?
It's talking about revenue officers doing collections, and since partnerships are not tax-paying entities, it would not directly apply to partnerships because taxes paid by the individual partners. And again, these things are promulgated for the administrative convenience of the IRS. They don't create a taxpayer right to file with other IRS employees in contravention of 90 years of precedent. And you had a second question, Your Honor?
Yeah, well, I guess my question is leading off how we started the day, how can this this memo be consistent with the regs if it's saying that if the regs demand that the returns be sent to the place of filing and this says it doesn't, how is that consistent with the regs?
Because these procedures are there not to contravene the regs, but put in there for the convenience of the IRS, administrative convenience of the IRS, and also to give some
How is the taxpayer supposed to know that? So basically, this memo says that you can send it to the IRS agent, and then it's the IRS's agent's pure discretion to forward it on to the service center or not.
What would normally happen is the taxpayer could approach the IRS agent and say, please help me get this filed. Or the IRS agent would say, I want your return so I can send it along and process it. But there are lots of people in the IRS processing millions of returns, and these things need to be made clear. The taxpayer always has the power to mail something to the service center and get things going. These are provisions there to help the IRS, to help the taxpayer, and in this case, Seaview, which has pursued its own technicalities, take the first Seaview case where they were arguing small partnership to retain the benefit of this deduction.
So do you acknowledge that the agent who actually got the copy of the return from the taxpayer never told the taxpayer that either one, he was not going to send this on to the service center, or two, gave the advice that, if you really want to make sure that this is going to be audited correctly, you should make sure that it's filed. There is no evidence that the IRS did either of those. Is that correct?
The revenue agent did say, we have no record of your return, but Seaview continued to maintain up into the tax court that they had filed in 2002. So it was within that context that the revenue agent was respecting Seaview's.
But don't you think the subtle, not even subtle message, the clear message from the IRS agent to the taxpayer is, okay, now you've sent me a copy of the return. We are beginning the audit. We're going to start a whole audit. Send me some additional information. The audit is proceeding. Don't you think that is a pretty direct statement to the taxpayer that essentially the copy has been accepted as a filing of the return, and therefore we can begin the audit process? Don't you think that is essentially the statement that is made to the taxpayer?
The IRS, if you look at the Coffee case, if you look at going back to W.H. Hill in the 1930s, the IRS, the revenue agent's job is to audit returns. You can audit a return from a copy, from a working copy. It is up to the taxpayer to make sure that there's meticulous compliance and that it gets filed. And there are multiple opportunities to do that and to confirm. In this case, Seaview never represented. We wish this document to be treated as our return. And please make sure it gets filed, even as we're arguing we did comply back in 2002. So we are standing on all of this precedent now. And had Seaview said, please help us get this filed, had made that representation, I trust that Revenue Agent Johnson or Attorney Forsberg would have rendered that assistance. So if there are no further questions, we ask the court to affirm, and we thank the court for its time.
Thank you, Mr. Shannon. Ms. Blatt, you had a couple minutes. There we go, it's on the clock now. Please go ahead.
Thanks. There's something Kafkaesque about a meticulous compliance rule when no one can tell what the IRS rules are. This may have been a sophisticated partnership.
Wait a minute. What are the rules? So the regulations are promulgated and published. The statutes are as well. But these manual sections are not published in the same way. First of all, does Seaview even claim that they knew about these manual sections and relied upon them? I mean, I saw nothing in the record to suggest that they knew about these manual sections and had any reliance.
Seaview relied on the IRS's instruction to send its tax return. You're correct, there's no evidence that they saw the manual, but it's not clear why a taxpayer, whether it be a mom and pop.
Wait a minute. So when Seaview sent the copies to the auditor and the attorney, when they were told we don't have a copy, or we don't have this filing, and so this has been filed in 2002, they were somehow at the same time relying on the auditor to file it for them, even though they were affirmatively and repeatedly for years asserting that it had been filed. How were they possibly relying on the auditor to file it for them?
Because the only reason any taxpayer has any consultation or any dealings with the IRS is to report income for official purposes so the IRS can collect taxes. So it's unbelievable that the IRS is saying that we thought we were sending the return for any other purpose than for the IRS to put it in the official record for what they do with all the tax returns, which is to make sure you report your income and that they audit you. If I could just clear up something about the regulation, because you keep citing it. There are two regulations at issue here. We are not adding anything to this other than adopting the IRS's own interpretation that they have two regulations that apply to filing, and directly sending it to the auditor does not meet the service center regulation. It meets the hand carried regulation. And in that memorandum, it says this is not limited to hand carry.
Sure, this is the IRS's regulation. When you look at the sections that talk about how you the place of filing, the hand carry provisions are not addressed to partnerships. As persons other than corporations, I mean, there's very specific ways in which hand carry applies. But the specific section that talks about how a partnership makes a return does not include hand carry. I don't think it includes a corporation either.
I disagree, because the regulation, I think it's the 609D4 or something, says other than a corporation. But in any event, footnote 9 of the IRS's brief cites these very regulations applying to partnerships. The IRS has never briefed this. For the first time, we're hearing revenue officers doesn't apply to partnerships. But they elsewhere say that any service representative and any examiner who receives an audit can file it. If I could just read you this statement.
Well, sure. I mean, you don't have to read to me. I've read the tax advice letter, which, as I understand, is only applicable to the taxpayer asking a question. I've read the 2005 sections from the manual, which are not regulations. They're internal manual. And I guess the other thing that's troubling to me is your definition of return as only being a timely return seems to be, put it mildly, tension with your second argument that when these documents were sent to the revenue agent, that they were a return, and you rely on the Beer test. But Beer doesn't say anything about it being timely. So if your definition of a return is it's got to be timely, then
our definition of filing was a return. Yeah, there's no question a return is a return is a return.
How do you say that when the time, place, and manner requirements in section, regulatory section 1.6031E require that it be returned to the service center, it doesn't apply because in that instance, return only means timely return.
So, Judge Bates,
you're parsing out the word return and giving it a definition that you like in one place, but ignoring it throughout the rest of that regulation and the cross-reference regulations.
The IRS's view is that there is a correct filing of a tax return if you file a late tax return with either the service center or the auditor. That is the IRS's view. If they want to brief why it doesn't apply to partnerships, that's fine. It's not something that's the opposite of what they said in their brief. But their view is if tomorrow they can keep telling taxpayers this document is filed and in fact it's in your interest to file it, we don't want you mailing it to the service center. The opening line of that memo is that the IRS frequently demands that taxpayers file directly with the auditor.
I don't think the regulations can be read as you construe them under any circumstances, but this could be a different case or certainly a different argument if the taxpayer here had at any instance indicated that this thing wasn't filed, given the auditor any reason to think this is delinquent, I'm going to go to these manual sections now, and I'm going to forward it to the service center for filing. Or if the agent had told the taxpayer anything to make the taxpayer think this was being filed when it was mailed to the auditor. There's
the
nothing
IRS,
in responses that suggested that happened. Or the IRS that was relying on that.
Because the IRS's policy statement is that for filing purposes, any tax return that gets in the hands of auditors, whether the auditor requested or it's sent by the taxpayer, counts as a filing.
And wait, you're using terms like policy statement. Let's be very precise here. The only, are you talking about the 1999 tax advice letter?
No, the 2006 policy statement says.
Oh, okay. The 2006 policy statement, which is like a few sentences long and is post-dates the time that the auditor interacted with the taxpayer here, it's from August 2006.
The key fact is the IRS has not said that we're being incorrect and that the way they administer the tax code and the way they want
this. What they say in that document is if we'll accept it. They don't say we'll file it for you or what they'll do with it. And I think when you look at that closely, it's talking about those regs and those manual sections you cite talk about when there are badges of fraud and what the IRS will or will not do. They do things differently. And then you have this later policy manual that comes out and says, we'll accept them. That's not the same wording that you're suggesting, that the IRS is promulgating some strong statement that any taxpayer who's filing is late can mail it, even when he's not asked for, to any IRS employee anywhere in the country.
No, that's not our view. Our view is that when you meticulously comply with the IRS's official instructions, get me your tax return, that counts as a filing. Our view is not that you can
You meticulously comply when an agent asks you for information about your return and you send a copy and say this was filed. That means that it's filed.
That's the way the IRS is not denying. The only argument that my opposing counsel has said is that because we weren't clear enough. He's not said Ms. Blatt was incorrect in her brief. He had a whole reply. He had 60 pages to say I was incorrect. And he didn't. They are conceding that they administer the tax code exactly the way we're saying it. And they say they want to have their cake and eat it.
I read those briefs and I did not see that concession. They were arguing meticulous compliance. The regulation requires a specific place of filing and you didn't do it. I think that's a far cry from saying that they conceded that a taxpayer can.
Because when they got to the manual, they said, well, doesn't have the force and effect of creating rights. And we agree. It has the force and effect of showing the way they administered the tax code and that they appropriately
So they could do that if they chose to do so. But does that mean that the taxpayers then absolved from complying with the regulations that require a particular place of filing?
No, and I would like to leave you with this. If the IRS is sloppy and not clear, you should not penalize taxpayers who simply do exactly what the IRS said, which is get them their return. The CD should not hold it against it.
You argue like this is Kafka-esque and equities, et cetera. And that's an interesting argument here, given very, very sophisticated taxpayer with top drawer counsel, CPA, two different CPAs, accounting advice, who are not being bamboozled or misled by the IRS, but are instead repeatedly telling the IRS, we filed this. They said that when they sent it, they sent a copy of a certified mail receipt. They went into deposition and had two different people testify as to that. But at the same time, you're saying the IRS bamboozled them because it didn't go, nope, this is delinquent and we're going to file it for you.
So any taxpayer who misses the deadline, just like this taxpayer, is subject to criminal and civil penalties. So there's no windfall here that if you miss the deadline, you're subject to late fees and includes criminal penalties.
It shouldn't, which would be a reason to cling to your argument that it's filed. We don't want to be subject to penalties or criminal prosecution. I mean, you want the statute of limitations to start running in 2002. I mean, these all seem like strategic decisions on the part of Seaview. But this is what they chose to do. And now when that didn't work out, then they want to say, well, gosh, then, you know, we didn't know about these regs. We didn't rely on them. But nonetheless, this thing was filed in 2005.
Say when the ABA and that the taxpayer brief filed by Harvard says the IRS accepts delinquent tax returns by auditors, that it was common knowledge and can be imputed to sophisticated. The fact that this was a sophisticated taxpayer and auditors and law firms just show you that sophisticated people think the IRS is continuing its practice.
It seems like what your claim comes down to is the IRS had these internal policy manuals where there were instructions to auditors what to do if they received a delinquent return. and they would send it to the proper place for filing. And that didn't happen here. So it was never filed. It was never sent to the service center. But your argument is that even though these manual sections create no rights for the taxpayer and they aren't enforced of law, if the IRS didn't follow that manual section, then that means that we have to consider the return filed, even if it was never sent to the service center.
So there are two arguments. One is directly based on sort of the Accardi principle that if the IRS fails to follow its own rules, the failure to follow the manual as invalid. But there's second, and I think a more common sense way to resolve this case, is that if the IRS wants the benefit of the meticulous compliance rule, it should make clear and publish guidance. The stuff I'm citing is all on the current website, publicly facing documents to anyone and everyone. It should just make clear.
I guess your argument, I mean, it requires a couple of things. So for Accardi to apply, we would have to conclude that those manual sections were promulgated for the benefit of the taxpayer as opposed to for the benefit of the IRS. And then, I mean, what about the idea that the IRS has published and made publicly available regulations that tell you the time, place, and manner of filing a return? That's how they've communicated to their taxpayers.
Yes, and they are communicating to their own agents and to taxpayers alike that the regulation that you and we've been discussing the whole time that says mail to the service center is not the exclusive place. It's certainly one place. Absolutely, I'm agreeing with you that the IRS thinks that delinquent returns can and should go. But what they've also told their own auditors and taxpayers is that there's another way to file delinquent returns that's in the best interest of the IRS and the taxpayer. Because the service center, the fact that there are millions of tax returns suggests exactly why they don't want. The IRS, if we lose this case, is not going to retract its guidance. They want taxpayers to file late returns with auditors because those are the people who were ready, willing, and standing by to process it in terms of processing the tax bill and assessing liability.
Okay, well, we're over time. So, Council, thank you both for your arguments this morning. It's very helpful. And for your patience with my barking dogs and for us taking so far over time. This case will be submitted. Thank you.